What I was trying to give is a larger picture, a larger understanding, not the micro issues at every place. Whether this happened in part of India, or have you listed all the possibilities, it's not that. It's not possible to do in 40 minutes, 50 minutes, 1 hour. I can do that, but that will take long time. What I was trying to give, and will also try to give in this session, that what are the larger pictures, what are the problems, and what are the possibilities of overcoming the problem and establishing a better system, energy system. And as I have started with saying, energy is the fundamental driver of not only human society, the entire biotic world and entire abiotic world. Entire universe, actually, the matter is there. Unless energy is spent, you can't run the matter. The stars will not burn, the planets will not move, the human beings, I will not speak. Everything requires input of energy and conversion of energy. So in that sense, it's very important to understand how energy contributed to primarily human evolution and human well-being and human civilization and human society. But also in this session, I'd like to just bring up a touch upon, which I started in the first session, that are we all, when we say we need energy, who are the we? These are 134 crore Indians, or 762 crore global human beings, or there are more than that? What does all mean? All human beings are 762 crores. And animals too. And plants too. So when we talk of, yes? We actually don't interact so much outside our atmosphere. So when we talk about energy needs, it's the system that is the earth, the terrestrial system, the energy. Because if we talk about the stars and all, that's an apparent matter.
The use of coal or oil in our satellites in the international space?
We don't use coal and oil in satellites to run. But to manufacture them, there's a very, very minor amount of energy is used. And outside the atmosphere, our energy use don't have much impact. It's up to the atmosphere, the lithosphere, the hydrosphere, and the atmosphere. These three are the most impacted. Neither the Earth's interior are affected or impacted. It's only the lithosphere, the top layers, the hydrosphere, which is the most impacted, and the atmosphere. These are the impacted areas. These are the areas we take energy from and we dump our waste. We take the resources and dump our waste. So this is the area that we are concerned about. But just to remind us that apart from this roughly 762 crore human beings in the world, roughly 134 Indians, how many species does the earth has, known species? How many species have been identified? Not billion. Identification is around 1.9 million species, 19 lakh species. We are just one of them. As Homo sapiens, we are just one of them. So there are 19 lakh other known species, and scientists estimate there are something like 70 to 80 lakh other species, which we have not yet discovered. So they also need some energy. The plants, all kinds of plant world and animal world also need energy. So all the energy available in the ecosystems of the earth, we cannot take and use. That's one principle we have forgotten entirely. The anthropocentrism, one very critical principle that we must understand before we start to understand energy and society and resources, that we must stop being anthropocentric. Anthropocentric means everything centered around human thinking. We, 134 crore Indians, how many plants do India have? How many animals do India have? How many insects do India have? Do they need energy? They need energy. All the ecosystems of the earth need energy. Nothing, no ecosystem works without energy circulation. So when we think about the available energy and how much we as Homo sapiens of a particular geography can use, we must also think, what is the total availability of energy in this ecosystem, and what is the necessary amounts by all the other plants, animals, and the ecosystem of the earth in that region. So, and that cannot be compromised. Because as of now, do anybody has an idea how much is our footprint? You know, there are several concepts of footprints. One is the carbon footprint. One is the ecological footprint, which is the most comprehensive. One is the water footprint. How much is our total ecological footprint and how much is available on the world? I said that yesterday. Any remembrance?
680.
No, that's the oil consumption, energy consumption.
We would need per annum.
Yes.
At our current consumption rates, we would need 1.7 earths in the...
Yes, that's a 1.7 earth. Today, the available global hectares, because everything that we consume from the earth has to produce, and some land and water is needed for that. And every waste that we throw down or throw out has to be recirculated by the earth again. So collected together, this is our ecological footprint. Today, we have an average ecological footprint of 2.8 global hectares per person. If you calculate the total number of persons and calculate the total amount of land and water area of the earth, this is something like 1.8 hectares per person is available. We are consuming 2.8. That means literally we are eating the earth. What does that mean? That means the earth's productive capacity of producing energy, producing minerals, producing water resources, producing biological products, everything is getting reduced every year. Whereas our demand, the demand is growing, the supply is going down. We are already over consuming. So where will it go? Where will it end? So that's what a major crisis. All this crisis that I talked about. Yes. This is for the world. This figure for India is 1.8 hectares, which is roughly equal to the maximum availability. The figure for US is 7 global hectares per person per year. So you know where the cut down has to begin, where the drastic cut down has to begin. That's why yesterday I was quite disturbed by this population. It's very popular in US and northern countries. Oh, it's the population, but it's a rubbish argument. Every US citizen consumes and wastes. Every US citizen is 12 to 14 times as destructive as an Indian citizen. So if you have to cut down Indian population, for every Indian man, cut down or woman or a child, cut down 12 of US, it's equal impact on the earth. So this population argument is rubbish. I'm not saying population has no impact. Population has an impact, but that's not the primary driver of consumption and pollution. So what I was trying to say is, when we talk about resources, and energy is one primary resource, we cannot be anthropocentric. And all our thinking had been anthropocentric. All the talk we do about energy, energy finance, energy this, energy that, everything is anthropocentric. And anthropocentrism first has to stop if we have to have a sustainable earth. If we talk about sustainable energy, sustainability cannot happen if you eat away all your plants, if you kill all your animals, and if you have lot of electricity and oil. It cannot happen. Everybody understand that. So the first condition of transition to a sustainable energy world is you have to stop being anthropocentric. That's again not discussed in energy seminars, but that is the central question. Because your ecosystems, plants, animals, everything has a fairly large need for energy. Second, the second central question about transition. What do you understand by transition in a sense? Like Om also said, from how do we go from coal to renewable? That's the global understanding in general about transition. But yesterday also I mentioned this, if I remember correctly. There is a very sharp, clear line now between the northern discussion and the discussion that is originating from the south. It has also spread, and part of that global discussion is that how much energy is sustainably possible to be harvested per person? Is energy access and use possible at a sustainable level without equity? Equity is another central question. As I said, if an average US citizen consumes 12,500 kilowatt hours per year, and an average Bihari citizen consumes 170, will not that Bihari person or an average Delhi citizen consumes 2050 per year, will not that Bihar person aspire to at least 2000 or 1500? And then by that time the Delhi person will go to 3500 or 4000. So already, if you are already over consuming the earth, then on top of that, if everybody wants to grow and grow and grow, what does that lead to? Destruction. So that's, those are the destructions we are actually facing today, and energy is at the pinnacle, at the top of that. The next impact will be the other form of energy, which has already started, food. There is already a major hit of world's food supply. There are studies that across all coal power plants, 15 to 20 kilometer diameter, the plant productivity has gone down by 15 to 20%. So that's a direct hit on the energy supply as food. That's the most vital source of energy. So the central questions, one, stop being anthropocentric. Our thinking about energy system has to be nature-centric, earth-centric, not anthropocentric. We have to understand that there are lots of biological ecosystem that needs energy, and there are calculations how much minimum energy each ecosystem needs. None of these are very precise in physics sense, but they are reasonably good estimates how much energy you need, those ecosystems need. Plants, animals and ecosystems as a whole, they need energy. Then what is the question, role of equity? Because without an equitable access, the global and national energy policies never talk about equity. They completely ignore the question of equity. Like the SDG 7 talks about universal access to affordable modern energy, but it do not talk about to what extent can a Mukesh Ambani family consume 75 megawatts of electricity and a Bihar family have no electricity. Can that happen, or can get 10 kilowatt hour? Is that sustainable situation? These questions are very central to understand the energy transition. Because what I am trying to hit at is the transition, the global debate on energy transition now centers around, as of now, some of us have contributed to broaden this discussion over the last couple of years, mostly 3 years. Otherwise, the major global discourse on energy transition, I was in Bonn last November, and there were at least 6 meetings that I attended, spoke in. 3 of them were on energy transition. They talk about 2 things: how to transition from coal and oil and gas to renewables, number one. And there is the second element. What is the second element? Anyone has any idea? There are 2 elements that are being talked about in the transition. The second element is the not at all. That's not they are interested in. The second element, efficiency, is a very normal thing. Efficiency is not a very major thing. I'll come to that. We have, the World Bank loves efficiencies, and World Bank and other institutions love us to keep talking about efficiencies. I'll talk about what is the Jevons paradox, how efficiency is really nothing very important. It will happen, it will keep happening. But the other thing that the global transition debate talks about is the rights of the dirty energy industry workers. There are millions of workers in the coal mines. There are millions of workers in the coal power plants, nuclear power plants, hydroelectric power plants. There are millions of workers involved in transporting coal and oil and gas and drilling and offshore and onshore drilling and etc. So the second talk that goes on, the second level of discussion, element of transition that they talk about, and I have participated in many of these, is that what will happen if you are going to stop coal in the next 20 years? What happens to the millions of workers in the coal mines and the coal power plants? So they demand that these workers need to be retrained, reskilled, re-employed in the new renewable energy industries. That's fine. But the questions that particularly I have raised in many of these, now in several global unions and other places and 2 or 3 others, is that what happens then to the many more millions of people who have been impacted by this coal, hydro, nuclear, etc. industries? because the workers, the formal workers, have benefited out of this fossil fuel use. They have benefited. They have reasonably good jobs. A Coal India formal employee earns how much? 50,000, 60,000, 70,000 rupees per month, roughly that. But the people who have been displaced by the coal mines, by the coal power plants, by the big hydro plants, they have not got anything. In fact, their resources have been taken away. So when we talk about a transition, do we also talk about giving back something to them? Should that be part of the transition? That's a major question. Very few groups, the trade unions, I talked to several global trade unions. They said, yes, this was in November last year in Bonn during the climate conference. Two of these meetings I talked about. One, there was a Friends of the Earth and global some trade unions and everyone, some European groups, collectives, and one was in the Indian pavilion. All of them said, it's a very important aspect, but we don't know, we have not thought about this. And this number roughly is 10 times the people who are working in the dirty energy industry, that is coal, oil and gas industries. This number is roughly 10 times that number, if not more, because there is no very right estimate. But roughly 10 times the number of people have been affected by the dirty energy industries badly. So what happens to them? They are forgotten? That's not a right transition. The fourth element in energy transition, that's the very critical question, is how much energy can be taken even if you consider that every energy source will be converted to renewable. Supposing every coal, oil, gas, nuclear and big hydro is tomorrow disappears, or 30 years hence we replace all this by solar, wind, geothermal, renewable energy. Can we come back to the present level of energy consumption? So very clear answer to this, if you consider, what sets the limit? Which government or even sets the limit? How much energy you can take? Is there, have you seen any government?
No, the motivation is always to keep expanding.
So is there a limit? Have you seen any government put a limit? Even putting a limit? I have not seen.
Ever growing, but
is the earth so dynamic that in the earth the energy sources will keep growing? There is a fixed amount of solar energy that comes to the earth. Out of that, there is a reasonably fixed amount of wind energy which is driven by part of the solar energy. There is a fixed amount of hydrological cycle. Water is evaporated, taken to the higher altitude and then comes down as flow. That is the hydropower. That's solar energy basically. So there is a very fixed amount of solar energy and all the derivative solar energies. Direct solar energy is fixed. 1376 watt at the top of the atmosphere per square meter. Roughly 1 square meter when it comes directly, 1 kilowatt per square meter. Only for 5-6 hours a day. So that's a fixed amount of energy. Earth do not get any more from the sun. Tomorrow we cannot increase the regulator and sun starts giving more energy. That's not possible. We don't understand how the sun's energy production is controlled. Today, science don't understand that. How that thermonuclear reaction is controlled, why the sun sometimes gives a little more, sometimes gives a little. Now, incidentally, the 24th cycle, we are in the 24th cycle solar cycle, and this is one of the lowest energy producing cycles. And we are having the highest temperatures in recorded history. So that's the indication of kind of catastrophe we are leading to. The next, the 25th solar cycle, which will come in 3-4 years, might be a normal. And then the solar energy input will grow. And then with our all carbon dioxide and everything, what will happen? I don't know. Science, as of now, don't have any exact estimate. But temperatures and other effects will shoot up. This is incidentally, over the last 100 years, the 24th solar cycle we are in, the sun has an 11-year cycle of giving higher and lower power. So we are in the lowest part in the last 100 years. And we are the highest part in global temperatures. So that's the kind of threat as of now we are facing. So can, there is an 11-year cycle in the sun when the sun becomes more active and less active. It's like a sine wave. All of you know what is a sine wave? It's like this.
If you double this, it's a sine wave. It goes up and goes down here and comes back to the origin. The sun has a roughly 11-year cycle. The sun has another 19,000-year cycle. The sun has another 40,000-year cycle and another 99,000-year cycle. So the solar energy input to the earth, actually the ice ages are determined by this 40,000-year-old cycle. That's why roughly 20 to 40,000 years, there is a cooling and there is a heating. But the present global warming has nothing to do with that. It's driven by the GHGs, the greenhouse gases, primarily carbon dioxide, but also methane and others. So we are at the lowest in the last 100 years. This is the 24th solar cycle that is being instrumentally measured. And this is the lowest. And we are having the highest temperatures. This is something to really be alarmed of. But forget about that. I was talking about what are the other elements in transition. And the most important, as I chalked out, the four element. The fifth element is how much you can take from nature. And nature means what is available on the earth. You cannot put a pipeline to the Jupiter and get some hydrogen. It's not possible as yet. Not even scientifically, technologically, it's not possible. So what is there on the earth, we have to depend on that. And considering that there are 1.9 million species out there who also need some energy, not as much energy as Homo sapiens, and there are large number of ecosystems which also needs energy. So keeping this in mind, going not totally divorcing, but at least going a little out of the anthropocentrism, the anthropocentric energy and global view, worldview framework, we have to come out of this anthropocentric worldview. There is no solution within that, very clearly. But then, how much can we take? That's a very critical question. Globally, no major group is willing to address. In fact, I had long debates in 2015 and 16, even with the climate justice circle, in the climate justice now and demand climate justice groups, to make them understand that the transition is not only from a fossil fuel to a renewable energy society. The transition has to be from high energy consumption to low energy consumption societies. And those are possible. There are ways and ways. The example that I gave yesterday, taking roughly half our energy, if countries can have much higher human development index, then why can't the global society as a whole can do that? That can do that. We are being driven by profit-hungry energy industry. Actually, present energy consumption patterns have been built up with designs by oil and coal companies. You know about the US history. In US, there are good bus services and tram services in many cities. The car companies actually bought up entire bus services and dismantled them. The car companies bought up tramways and dismantled them so that people are dependent on cars. And what is the difference between going in a bus and going in an individual car, private car? Any idea? Both in energy and pollution terms, if you go by air conditioned, yes, you are saying something? Any idea?
Lowest time and pollution.
Lowest, how much? Lowest, highest doesn't have any meaning. These are all subjective terms. If you go by a bus, which is reasonably occupied, say 70% occupied, even by an air conditioned bus, the per passenger kilometer carbon dioxide emission, and carbon dioxide emission is directly connected with your energy consumption. Because in the Indian coal power plants, 1 kilowatt of energy generation in a coal power plant in India emits about 1 kg of carbon dioxide. So direct connection and other pollutants. So if you go by an air-conditioned bus, the per passenger kilometer emission is something like 9 to 12 grams per passenger kilometers. If you take the smallest car, Alto, and go alone, the per passenger kilometer emission is 110 grams of carbon dioxide per passenger kilometer. And if you go by a Honda City kind of thing, it is around 160 to 170. That means more than 10 times per passenger kilometer. And this transition from a public transportation is a basic need. Someone was asking about transportation here during the break, tea break. So transportation is a basic need of human society. But what kind of transportation we will have, what kind of transportation as a sustainable energy system And transportation is responsible for 14% of global energy consumption today, roughly 14%. Of course, some part is not calculated, yes? There are many studies on metros, trains, bullet trains, everything. But if I go right now into all details, I will not have time. There are studies we can give you, all exact figures, means rough figures we can give you. So the question is, what kind of energy we can extract? Can we sustain a system where people are, have access, right to have the cars? We cannot. Very clear answers. How many cars do you have today in the world? Rough idea. How many private, these cars, forget about buses and trucks, how many do you have? Around 900 million cars we have today. How many people do we have? 7.62 billion. Okay, roughly 1.8 to 1.9 billion families. So if you think that every family has right to at least one car, because many families have two cars, some families have three cars. So if cars is acceptable, private cars are acceptable, then as a right, every family should have at least right to one car, and they should be provided that kind of opportunity to own and have a car. That will lead to 2 billion cars very soon. So more than double. Where will that extra steel, plastic, glass, other metal, aluminium will come from? Where will they be dumped? That will more than double your extractive industry globally. Globally, the extractive industry is already beyond sustainability. The amount of steel we mine, the amount of aluminium ore, bauxite we mine, the steel ores we mine is already beyond sustainability. If we double this just because of the cars, and these are very intensive on steel, aluminium and glass and plastics. So clearly, what kind of energy future we can sustain? Sustainability. And as I said, if equity aspect is not considered, like if you keep on thinking one person can have 10 cars and other have no right to have a car, I can have a big car, but when Anirudh buys a car, why you are making pollution? So that's not a sustainable system, because equity is a central principle. So in that system, we cannot have privatized car-based transportation. You can have private cycles and maybe scooters at most. Beyond that, private transportation is clearly out of the question in a sustainable energy future. What are the other issues? Presently, as I said yesterday and today I mentioned, our energy, India's energy, our means Indian societies is 680 kgs of oil equivalent, considering every source, commercial, industrial, domestic, everything, educational institute, hospitals, everything. But then, and at India, we are roughly at the upper limit what the earth can sustain per person per year. The calculations are the maximum sustainable, equitable per person consumption is not more than 1 ton, roughly around a ton. So we are at 680 kgs. We have a little more margin. The US is 6,000 kgs. The Europe consumes more than 4,000 kgs of oil equivalent. So those societies, and who is going to tell them, why you can't consume this much, you have to come down, you have to cut down. And some estimates are, the US needs to cut down by more than 75 to 80% of their total energy consumption, if they have to have any semblance of sustainability, any semblance, not a full sustainability. They have to cut down by 80%. They have to come down to 20% energy consumption as today they consume. That's the level of sustainability. Who dictates that? Earth. It's not the UN, it's not the governments, it's the earth which dictates that. That this is the maximal available energy which is within the sustainability parameters. And I'm clearly saying there are calculations, there are clear indications that we can have a reasonably comfortable society within these energy levels. Because today, roughly 75% of the global energy consumption goes into wasteful consumption. 35% of the global energy consumption goes into war industry. We don't need wars to sustain. Do we need wars to sustain? Like, once there is a war, Anirudh will be richer. You will be richer. You might give some financial advice. But do we need that? So 35% of the global energy consumption goes into war industry. We can cut it down. Something like 25% of the global consumption goes into high-end luxury. like I am flying on a holiday to Mauritius or to God's own country. I like Joe's country very like very much. So I will fly to God's own country once a year, twice a year. Of course, when we fly to Chennai for a workshop, our footprints are zoom like that. So I try to cut down my flying, but sometimes I know I am doing a bad thing. But that's the reality. Once we have to move around too much, we have to change somewhere. I don't know. Maybe more on Skype and more on like this. So that's the reality. Because whatever we say, we can't be hypocrites continuously. We can't say something and do completely different things continuously. And consumption is differentiated. Consumption, energy consumption, and pollution. These are very clearly connected. Because if you consume energy, you will have to pollute. There is no other way. People have not found out any other way as of now. So consumption and pollution are connected. So wherever you have to, if you have to really think about and do something about sustainability of the world, live very comfortably at this level. Like if you take India as a whole, Indian total energy consumption is still at sustainable level, not ours. Because overwhelming majority of Indians consumes very little and we consume quite high. So it is averaged out. But do we have the right to continue to consume? Like as I said, do Delhiites, Delhi people have a right to consume 2050 kilowatt hour per person? Within Delhi, many of us might be consuming much more than that. Because Delhi has a lot of people who consume much less than that. So do we have a right to keep on consuming 10 times the other in the same area and preach what we are doing? We don't have that right. The unfortunate thing is often we don't understand what we are saying and what we are doing. So, of course, if we have to act intelligently and effectively, first thing is understanding what we are saying. So that is the fifth element or sixth element. The last element I will say, which occupies all our discussion, is transitioning from fossil fuel to renewable. In my understanding, that is the easiest thing to do. The technologies exist. The methodologies exist. We are going in a wrong way. We can go in the right way. How much is the, see, our energy consumption, as I said in the first session, is not only electricity. Till today, 16% of Indian energy, primary energy consumption is in the form of electricity. How much is the form of non-commercial energy, largely biomass India consumes? It's around 18% of our total energy. So biomass, non-commercial energy, even today in this modern 21st century, we get more energy than all our electricity gives us. And that is totally neglected from our energy policies, energy thinking. And biomass, as of now, is very inefficiently used. When you burn biomass in a very rough chula, it gives only around 5 to 6% of the energy as effective energy. This can be improved drastically. There are existing designs. Little bit of engineering can be done. Lot of IITs, others have done those engineering. But can we quickly come in? That's another point that must be kept in mind. Don't forget about things which are not fashionable. Because now no engineer is interested in biomass engineering. All of them are interested in solar doing something, or wind, or nuclear. They are more interested in nuclear. But biomass, it's out of fashion. It's purana ho gaya. Purana jamana ke baat hai. But leaving that apart also, even in the modern solar and wind, do we have enough solar and wind resources? Just I'm not suggesting that we put all our solar panels in one place or two place, but just as a calculation, our electricity needs today is roughly, if you consider the peak demand, say not even 1,75,000, say 2 lakh megawatt we need. 1 megawatt of installed solar capacity is not equal to 1 megawatt of installed coal capacity, because sun do not shine throughout the day. The plant load factor, as we calculate, for a solar plant is something like 20 to 22%. The present day plant load factor of coal power plants is around 60%. Now it has come down a little bit, 55, but that's because of coal shortage, power, less power demand, etc. It can easily run at 70%. So you need roughly 3.5 megawatt of solar plant, installed solar plant, to supply same amount of energy. Because installed power is in megawatt,
The energy we consumed is in megawatt hours. How many megawatt for how many hours that plant is producing? So a solar power plant, solar photovoltaic power plant, can produce less than one third. If the solar and coal power plant are the same capacity, solar and coal or solar and nuclear, then the solar can produce less than one third in a given time. So you need.
But that conversion cannot, because it can only produce during few hours. Of
but that's what I'm saying. That a solar power plant.
Solar, you still can't meet what the coal can.
You can. That's what I'm saying. Let me complete that. What I said, that's what is calculated as plant load factor. If you have 1 megawatt of plant installed, how many megawatt hours per year can it produce? A coal power plant can produce 3.5 times a 1 megawatt coal power plant if it runs well, if it is not short of coal, if it is not shut down often, normal, only 1.5 months maintenance, then a coal power plant of 1 megawatt can produce 3.5 times the energy of 1 megawatt solar power plant. So to replace equal energy term, a coal power plant of 1 megawatt, you need 3.5 megawatt of solar power plant. But when we calculate the produced energy, we don't talk about megawatt, we talk about megawatt hour. What is the requirement of megawatt hour? Today the Indian consumption is 1120 kilowatt hour per person per year. So we talk about solar power plants in terms of what is the cost of production of 1 megawatt hour. And today, as I said, 1 megawatt hour from a solar power plant in a reasonably sunny area cost around 2800 rupees, 2900 rupees, that is per kilowatt hour 2 rupees 80 paisa, 2 rupees 70 paisa, 2 rupees 90 paisa, maximum 3 rupees. So in a sense, we don't need to consider megawatt installed. We need to consider what is the cost of produced power through solar. But can we produce enough power that India will need now and in the next 10 years and 20 years through solar and wind? Just consider one area. Again, I am not proposing that all our solar power plants be placed in that area, because there are many others. Just for calculation, how much energy in terms of electricity we are needing now, running capacity? Say 180,000, increase it 2 lakh megawatt. So you will need 6 lakh megawatt at least of installed solar power plant, 3 times at least. In Rajasthan, there is a Thar desert which covers around 200,000 square kilometer. 200,000 square kilometer. Some parts of that have economic activity. Even in the desert, there are villages which depend on animal husbandry. There are once a year crop, very low growth, but crop they grow. If you leave aside those areas and the other model that I am coming to as the last point, that I will come to last. If you think of 100,000 square kilometer, leave half of the desert for people who are living for their animal husbandry, their other activities, even if you go for half the area, 1 lakh square kilometer, which has 320 cloud-free days, you have how much? How much area is needed for 1 megawatt of installed capacity? Actually 3 acres. 3 acres for 1 megawatt of installed capacity. So how many acres or how many hectares for a square kilometer? 100 hectares make 1 square kilometer. So if you have a little over here 1 hectare for a megawatt, then you have something like little less than 100, something like 70 megawatt per square kilometer. If you take other structures, commercial structure, offices, this, that, you can easily have 30 megawatt to 50 megawatt per square kilometer. Bring it down to 30, the lowest possible. Leave aside some areas. 30 megawatt per square kilometer. Multiply by that by 1 lakh. How much does it come to? India, China, entire power can come from that one area. So the question lot of people ask, that we don't have enough solar. Solar can never be the mainstream. Now, these are always. This is another question. Storage is not always needed. I'll come to that again, because I'm saying that there are hundreds of issues. These are micro issues. There are solutions for that. There are a lot of solutions for that. I'll come to that, but let me first answer the large question, then I'll come to this. First thing is, do we have enough solar and wind resources? We have more than enough. And I'm not talking about the Kutch in Gujarat, the Tamil Nadu areas, the Karnataka areas, the other areas, the Andhra Pradesh, large Deccan Plateau areas. I'm not talking about the multiple use of land, dual use of land. There are already established examples of people putting the solar panels on 3 meter height, leaving a little gap and doing some plantations underneath, some cultivation underneath. There's always there, it's there. Then I'm not talking about how many building, what is the building surface area, built surface area in India. There are anything between 24 to 30 crore houses. If you cover even half of those houses by solar panel, how much energy you can have? There was one study in Delhi, and it calculated 2,200 megawatt of electricity can be generated just by Delhi rooftops, taking a reasonable percentage. So these are micro estimates at different level you can go through. But the broader picture is, we have far more solar energy available as of now that we today consume, and in the next 20, 30, 40 years we can imagine that our electricity demand will grow, we can have. And I have not calculated the wind resources, which is now calculated at 150,000 megawatt. And that's at 80 meter half height. You know, the higher you go, the higher is the wind speed, and the energy of the wind is to the cube of the speed. So we have not gone into that, but the clear answer is we have more than enough solar and wind, that is the solar energy resources available, but we need to change the pattern that it is going. Today, the same Adanis, Ambanis, Ruiyas and others who have made the big coal power plants, who have operated the coal, taken the coal and polluted, these are the same companies who are being given concessions for thousands of acres of land to big centralized utility scale solar power plants. And solar and wind being very distributed, it's not concentrated in one place. See, the last point that I wanted to make is that actually we are losing a historic opportunity to turn around the entire energy system's control, the political economic control of the energy system. Coal, oil, nuclear has a capitalist character built in. Why? Because as a human, as a citizen, you cannot go and buy a coal mine. You can't start a coal power plant. But as a citizen, you can just buy some solar panels, put them on your rooftop. It's there on your roof. You can generate your own power or part of that power or even more than that. So coal, oil, gas matches the capitalist agenda very well. Solar and wind are very distributed. Human needs are distributed across the world. The renewable energies are distributed across the world, and nature is somehow, I don't know how, nature is something very complicated. Nature has played it very, very equitably. In the northern latitudes, there is little sun, but the wind velocity is much higher because of the three global winds. In the equatorial region, wind speed is low, the sun is very strong. So nature has distributed renewable energy quite equitably. The human need should be equitable. We should not accept that the US should have a right to use 12,500 kilowatts and 5,000 tons of oil, whereas Bangladesh uses 300 units of electricity per year per person and gets only 290 kg oil equivalent. That's unacceptable, as I said first. The equity has to come in. Equity is not equivalent to equality. Some climates will need more, some will need less. But equity should also not mean 10 times the difference or 20 times the difference, which is there today. So if you consider going out of the anthropocentric framework, bringing in the elements of equity, respecting that there are many other systems beyond humans who need energy, respecting that the earth has a limit, earth itself has imposed a limit on how much energy you can have per person, within a limit, within a reasonable limit, bringing in the question of equity, reasonable equity, not equality, and then considering that this is a historic opportunity. Now we are actually standing on the cusp of the next energy revolution. Like I said earlier in the first session, we have already gone through three levels of three energy transition in human history.
This is the forced energy transition, and we are losing the opportunity to take back the control democratically. So we are all ignorant about, almost all ignorant about, we talk about, oh, this should not happen, but we have to understand the global opportunity that has been given. Have we taken a stand that we will raise a movement that take back our energy resources? This is our energy. It's falling on my field, on my rooftop, in our village. We have the first right, and there is a global principle, which is not a law, of first user's right. You know that. There's a first user right, which is never a law, it is a principle, which is often admitted. So we are failing to assert that first user's right. If we don't use the energy that is in my land or on my rooftop, somebody tomorrow will come, and that is coming, that is happening. Big corporations, which has captured the fossil fuel energies and the nuclear energies and the hydro energy, the same companies are today coming in and capturing this democratic character renewable energies. And once that is captured, for the next 40, 50, 60 years, we will be losing it. So I think the energy transition has to start from these 7 very critical understandings, and this is one opportunity and a threat. If we lose this opportunity, and this is possibly the last major energy transition, unless the thermonuclear fusion comes in a very good fashion, which is very, very uncertain, nobody knows. But this will possibly be the last major energy transition on the earth. Next level will be where, we don't know. So the challenge is not just solar, coal to solar. That's a very minor thing. We know the technologies, the methods are known, the economics are known, the technology and the science is known, and it is improving like all others. So the challenge is at this 7 level. Can we think of in these terms? Can we bring back the elements of equity, justice, and democratic control of energy resources, which is possible today? Because nobody, as of now, no country, I don't know, there was some talk in one country, but no country has made a law that the solar energy that falls on your roof belongs to the government. No country has made a rule. But the coal that might be found under your land belongs to the government, that is there. The uranium that will be found under your land will belong to the government. But no country has made a rule that the wind that flows over your land is government's. No country has made. The solar energy that falls, this is an opportunity. Are we ready to take this opportunity, assert that control, and force the governments, okay, to everyone that has an access to air and wind and sun, will have the right. As a collective, as a community, as individuals, we have not done that. So these are the major challenges of the transition. And I'm ending by this statement. Most of our transition discussions are limited to coal to renewable. This is not going to solve us, this solve a problem. This is not going to solve any of the transition challenges. Thank you.
காலையில் வந்து என்னென்னலாம் ஃபண்டமெண்டலாக எனர்ஜி என்னென்ன எனர்ஜி சோர்சஸ் இருக்குதுன்னு பார்த்தோம். அடுத்து வந்து நம்ம எனர்ஜி டிரான்ஸ்மிஷனை பற்றி பேச போகிறோம். எனர்ஜி டிரான்ஸ்மிஷன் சொல்லும்போது ஹியூமன் சிவிலைசேஷன் வந்து ஒவ்வொரு காலகட்டத்திலையும் ஒவ்வொரு மாதிரியான எனர்ஜி டிரான்ஸ்மிஷன் அடைஞ்சிட்டு வந்திருக்கு. நம்ம இப்போ இருக்கிறது வந்து ஒரு நாலாவது கட்டத்தில் இருக்கும், ஒரு நாலாவது டிரான்ஸ்மிஷனில் இருக்கும். இப்போ கோல்லேருந்து ஒரு அன்சஸ்டைனபிளாக இருக்க ஃபாசில் ஃபியூவல்லேருந்து ரினுவபிளாக இருக்க போகிற ஒரு சோலார் எனர்ஜி நோக்கி நம்ம நடந்துகிட்ருக்கோம். அதனால் அதுக்குள்ளே இந்த டிரான்சிஷன் நடக்கிறப்ப என்னென்னலாம் நமக்கு சேலஞ்சஸ் இருக்குது அப்படின்னு சொல்லி சார் சொன்னார். அதில் பார்த்து என்னென்னலாம் பார்த்தோம்னா ஒவ்வொரு கூட்டமும் எப்படி, இப்போ ஒவ்வொரு கண்ட்ரிலையும் அவங்க கன்சம்ஷன் பேட்டர்ன் எப்படி வேரி ஆகுது. யூஎஸில் வந்து மற்றவங்கள விட மற்ற கண்ட்ரீஸோட அதிகமாக கன்சியூம் பண்ணுறது, இந்தியாவை பொறுத்த வரைக்கும் எவ்வளோ கன்சியூம் பண்ண முடியுமோ அந்த அளவுக்கு சஸ்டைனபிள் கன்சம்ஷன் லெவலில் இருக்கும். பட் இருந்தாலும் இது எந்த அளவுக்கு இருக்கும்னு தெரியல. அப்புறம் பாப்புலேஷனுங்கிறது வந்து ஒரு பொல்யூஷனுக்கான ஒரு முக்கிய காரணியாக நம்ம பார்க்க முடியாது. நம்ம திங்கிங் எல்லாமே எப்போவுமே ஒரு ஹியூமன் சென்ட்ரிக்காக மற்ற உலகத்தில் இருக்க மற்ற ஸ்பீஷீஸை விட்டுட்டு நம்மளது எப்போவுமே ஒரு ஆந்த்ரோபோசென்ட்ரிக், அதாவது மனிதர்களை நோக்கிய ஒரு யோசிச்சுக்கிட்டு இருக்கோம். ஒவ்வொரு செயலுமே நம்ம என்னென்ன பண்ணுமோ ஒரு ரோடுக்கும் நம்மக்கிட்ட இருக்க டெவலப்மெண்ட்ஸ் எல்லாமே ஹியூமன் சென்ட்ரிக்காக இருக்குது. நம்ம அடுத்த ஸ்பீசிஸை நம்ம கன்சிடரே பண்ண மாட்டேங்கிறதுக்குமே அப்புறம் நம்ம கன்சம்ஷன் வந்து நம்ம சிவிலைசேஷன்ஸ் இதுக்கு முன்னாடி இருந்த இண்டஸ் வேலி சிவிலைசேஷனாக இருக்கட்டும் இல்லை மற்ற பாலினேஷன் சிவிலைசேஷன்ஸாக இருக்கட்டும் எப்பயுமே அது டெஸ்ட்ராய் எப்போ ஆச்சுன்னா நம்ம எப்போ ஓவர் கன்சம்ஷனை நோக்கி போயிட்டுருக்கோமோ நம்ம கன்சம்ஷன் எப்போ அன்சஸ்டனபிள் லெவலாக இருக்கோ அப்போல்லாம் நம்ம சிவிலைசேஷன் வந்து டெஸ்ட்ராய் அழிஞ்சு போயிடும். அடுத்து வந்து குளோபல் டிரான்சிஷனில் இருக்க என்னென்ன சேலஞ்சஸ்ங்கிறது பார்த்தோம். நம்ம டிரான்சிஷன் எந்த மாதிரி இருக்கும், கோல் ஆயில் கேஸ் இதிலிருந்து நாம் எப்படி சோலாரை நோக்கி போக போகிறோம், மற்ற ரினியூவபிள் சோர்சஸ் நோக்கி போக போகிறோம், இது ஒரு சேலஞ்ச். அடுத்து வந்து இப்போ இருக்க கோல் பேஸ்டு அப்புறம் ஃபாசில் ஃபியூயல் பேஸ்டு ஒர்க்கர்ஸ் அவங்களோட ரைட்ஸ் இதெல்லாம் நாம் அட்ரஸ் பண்ணுறோமா, அது ஒன்று. நெக்ஸ்ட் வந்து இதில் இருக்க எம்ப்ளாயீஸ் வந்து ஓரளவுக்கு பெனிஃபிட் அடைஞ்சிருந்தாலும் இப்போ நம்ம செய்கிற அன்சஸ்டனபிள் கன்சம்ஷனாக இருக்குல்ல, கோல் மைனாக இருக்கட்டும் இல்லை பவர் பிளான்ட்ஸாக இருக்கட்டும், இந்த பவர் பிளான்ட்ஸ்னால டிஸ்பிளேஸ் பண்ணப்பட்ட மக்களுக்கு வந்து எந்த மாதிரியான அழிவுகளை நம்ம கொடுத்துருக்கோம், அவங்களோட வாழ்வாதாரத்துக்கு என்னென்ன பாதிப்புகள்லாம் ஏற்படுத்தியிருக்கோம் இதெல்லாம் நம்ம கன்சிடர் பண்ணோமாங்கிறது கிடையாது. அப்புறம் வந்து இப்போ நம்ம எஸ்டாப்ளிஷ் பண்ணியிருக்க கெப்பாசிட்டி ஆஃப் கோலோ சாரி தெர்மல் பவர் பிளான்ஸோ இல்லை மற்ற கன்சம்ஷனோ அந்த இதை ரீப்ளேஸ் பண்ணக்கூடிய அளவுக்கு வந்து நம்ம சோலார் பவர் பிளான்ட் வந்து எஸ்டாப்ளிஷ் பண்ண போகிறோமா அப்படிங்கிறது ஒரு கேள்வி. நெக்ஸ்ட் வந்து இப்போ இருக்க சோலார் கன்சம்ஷன் வந்து திஸ் சோலார் சைக்கிள் வந்து ஒரு 11 இயர் சைக்கிள், வி ஆர் இன் த லோவஸ்ட் பார்ட் ஆஃப் த சைக்கிள். த அமௌண்ட் ஆஃப் அந்த சூரிய ஒளியில் இருக்க சக்தி வந்து இப்போ இருந்து கம்மியான லெவலில் தான் இருக்குது. இருந்தாலும் நம்ம குளோபல் வார்மிங்னால நம்ம டெம்பரேச்சர் அதிகமாக இடத்துல ஃபீல் பண்ணிகிட்ருக்கோம். நம்ம எப்படி டிரான்சிஷன் ஃப்ரம் அதாவது ஒரு ஹை எனர்ஜி கன்சம்ஷன்லேருந்து லோ எனர்ஜி கன்சம்ஷனை நோக்கி எப்போ நகர போகிறோம், நம்மளோட கார்பன் ஃபுட் பிரிண்ட் அதாவது இப்போ ஒரு ஏசி பஸ்ஸில் நாம் போகிறதுக்கும் மற்ற டிரான்ஸ்போர்ட்டேஷன் யூஸ் பண்ணுறதுக்குமான எவ்வளோ கார்பன் ஃபுட் பிரிண்ட் இதெல்லாம் வந்து கணக்கெடுத்து பார்த்தோம்னா எது சஸ்டைனபிள்னு பார்க்கும்போது நம்ம ஒரு பஸ் எடுத்துகிட்டு போகிறது தான் நமக்கு ஒரு ஓவராலாக பார்த்தா சஸ்டைனபிளான ஒரு வழி. அது வந்து அதே சமயம் இந்த மாதிரி கார்ஸ் அந்த மாதிரி ப்ரைவேட் டிரான்ஸ்போர்ட்டேஷன்ஸ் எடுக்கும்போது அதுக்கான மேனுஃபேக்சரிங் ஃபுட் பிரிண்ட்ஸை பார்த்தோம்னா அதுக்கு தேவையான மெட்டல்ஸ் அயன் ஓர் அலுமினியம் இதெல்லாம் ப்ரொடியூஸ் பண்ணுறது விதம்லாம் இருக்குன்னா அதுவும் நம்ம நினச்சி பார்க்க முடியாத அளவுக்கு ஒரு ஹையஸ்ட் பொல்யூஷன் ஏற்படுத்துகிற விதமாக தான் இருக்கும். அப்புறம் டோட்டல் எனர்ஜி கன்சம்ஷன் எப்படி இருக்குன்னு பார்த்தீங்கன்னா 35% ஆஃப் த கன்சம்ஷன் இஸ் இந்த வார் இண்டஸ்ட்ரீஸ் அண்டு 25% வந்து நம்மளோட லக்ஸுரிக்காக நம்ம யூஸ் பண்ணிகிட்ருக்கோம். இந்தியாவோட ஓவரால் கன்சம்ஷன் வந்து இப்போ இருக்கிற லெவலில் வந்து சஸ்டைனபிளாக தான் நம்ம போயிட்டுருக்கோம். எவ்வளோ கன்சியூம் பண்ண முடியுமோ அந்தளவுக்கு மட்டும்தான் நம்ம இப்போ பண்ணிகிட்ருக்கோம். பயோமாஸ் கன்சம்ஷன் பற்றி பார்க்கும்போது அதோட யூசேஜ் வந்து எப்பயுமே ஒரு இன்எஃபிஷியண்ட்டான முறையில் இருக்குது. பயோமாஸோட கான்சன்ட்ரேஷன் வந்து ஒரு 18% ஆஃப் த டோட்டல் எனர்ஜி யூஸ் பண்ணுறதுல இருக்குது. அப்புறம் இப்போ ஒரு கோல் பவர் பிளான்ட் 1 MW ஆஃப் கோல் பவர் பிளான்ட் இருக்குன்னா அது ப்ரொடியூஸ் பண்ணுற எனர்ஜியை ரீப்ளேஸ் பண்ணுற அளவுக்கு நாம் ஒரு சோலார் பிளான்ட் போடணும்னு நினைக்கும்போது இதுக்கு இந்த 1 MW கெப்பாசிட்டி ஆஃப் கோல் ரீப்ளேஸ் பண்ணுறதுக்கு நம்ம 3 MW ஆஃப் சோலார் பிளான்ட் போக வேண்டியது இருக்கும். அப்புறம் இப்போ ராஜஸ்தான் எடுத்துக்கிட்டிங்கன்னா வி ஹாவ் அந்த பொட்டென்ஷியல் வந்து அங்கே சோலார் பொட்டென்ஷியல் வந்து ரொம்ப அதிகமாக இருக்குது. அங்கே ஒரு சோலார் பிளான்ட் எஸ்டாப்ளிஷ் பண்ணோம்னா பர் ஸ்கொயர் பர் ஸ்கொயர் கிலோமீட்டருக்கு 70 மெகாவாட் அளவுக்கு நம்ம நம்மளுக்கு போடுற அளவுக்கு சோலார் கெப்பாசிட்டி போடுற அளவுக்கு நமக்கு இது இடம் இருக்குது. அந்த அதில் வந்து ஒரு 1 lakh square kilometers அளவுக்கு அவைலபிள் லேண்ட் அவைலபிலிட்டி இருக்குது. அந்த லேண்டில் வந்து நம்ம இப்போ ஒரு சோலார் பவர் பிளான்ட் லார்ஜ் ஸ்கேல் பவர் பிளான்ட் ஒன்று எஸ்டாப்ளிஷ் பண்ணும்போது அதிலிருந்து ப்ரொடியூஸ் பண்ணக்கூடிய எனர்ஜி வந்து இந்தியா சைனா கம்பைண்டாக வந்து நம்ம மொத்த எனர்ஜி தேவைகளையும் மீட் பண்ணுற அளவுக்கு அதிலிருந்து ஒரு எனர்ஜி ப்ரொடியூஸ் பண்ண முடியும். அப்புறம் இது நம்ம எப்பயுமே யூஸ் பண்ணுற ஃபாசில் ஃபியூல்ஸாக இருக்க கோல், ஆயில் அண்ட் கேஸ் இதில் இருக்கிறது வந்து ஒரு கேபிட்டலிஸ்ட் நேச்சர். அவங்க ஒரு ப்ரைவேட்டைசேஷன் அந்த மாதிரி ஒரு நோக்கோட தான் அந்த எனர்ஜியை வந்து எஸ்டாப்ளிஷ் பண்ண பார்ப்பாங்க. ஒரு பவர் பிளான்ட் ஏதோ ஒன்று எஸ்டாப்ளிஷ் பண்ண பார்ப்பாங்க. அதில் அதை தவிர்த்து நம்ம ஒரு சோலாரையோ ஒரு விண்டையோ நோக்கி போகும்போது நமக்கு வந்து அதை எஸ்டாப்ளிஷ் பண்ணுறதுக்கு நமக்கு சுதந்திரம் இருக்குது. நம்ம ரூஃப் டாப்லேயே நம்ம ஒரு சோலார் பேனல் வச்சுட்டு நமக்கு தேவையான எனர்ஜியை நாமளே ப்ரொடியூஸ் பண்ணிக்கலாம். இந்த ஆப்பர்ச்சுனிட்டியை நம்ம யூஸ் பண்ணிக்கிட்டு ஒரு டர்ட்டி எனர்ஜி அதாவது கோல், ஆயில், நேச்சுரல் கேஸ் போன்ற ஃபாசில் ஃபியூல்லேருந்து நம்ம இந்த ஆப்பர்ச்சுனிட்டியை யூஸ் பண்ணி நம்ம ரெனியூவபிள் எனர்ஜிக்கு நம்ம மூவ் பண்ணுறதுக்கான சான்ஸ் எடுத்துக்கோம்.
So I was just trying to rack my brains on what I can add more to Soumya ji's presentation. So in this, what I thought I'll do is tell, I don't know how many of you have read the Electricity Act, everybody has read it, so no, okay, fine. So
only Soumya ji has read it.
Only Soumya. Finish that. Fine. So what I thought I'll do is in this presentation, I'll show you the website. I wanted to do this yesterday also, but in a different IFI's context. But what I thought I'll do is share a series of websites one way to actually make people understand the role of investment of renewable energy in India. How does that happen? In what context? What are the major drivers behind the renewable part? I'll also try to focus on, give an example of Tamil Nadu to see how investments in renewables are taking place. So that will probably give a context of the financial aspect to it from a more regulatory perspective, let's say. So, and also to kind of look at what are the issues that kind of prevent renewables from taking off, both utility scale and rooftop. So even administrative, legal, technical perspective. So the idea is, again, the Electricity Act 2003, that has been the driver for the change for the renewable energy market in India. What does this act say? The act is basically an act that allows the previously owned companies which were producing electricity, transmitting electricity and distributing electricity were all one electricity board. Then they kind of broke up into, from the Orissa experience, they broke up from the generation, transmission and distribution models. So the Electricity Act basically consolidates this approach and says any person can set up a plant, an electricity plant. It doesn't differentiate between you doing it or a big private entity doing it. So that's the basic idea, where rooftop solar you can put it up because you are generating electricity, anybody can do. But you need to get licenses, you need to get certain conditions fulfilled. So in that, the Electricity Act basically divides, makes generation privatized, where private people can do. Transmission is potentially private, but transmission lines are being set up at Tata and all that. Distribution is a single entity which can be potentially broken up, but the wires can't be duplicated. That's the idea. So the idea then again is distribution companies are government owned or fully private owned, like in Delhi where the Reliance owns it, and Mumbai where the Tata's and Reliance kind of own it. So that's the basic setup within which the Electricity Act puts it. So the next idea behind the Electricity Act is that all companies, all these companies must be run on commercial principles. So the element of profit immediately kicks in. So if the element of profit kicks in, then what happens? Then you need, if your local board puts one unit electricity for 25 to 30 rupees, you'll of course make a hue and cry, because that may not be the fair price. So in this setup, the Electricity Act has incorporated the system of electricity regulators. Regulators are bodies which basically act on the interest of the consumer as well as the utility to find a balance. So the typical example in Tamil Nadu is the Tamil Nadu Electricity Regulatory Commission. So the Electricity Regulatory Commission is where you get your, every year you get your prices fixed for the thing. So this is the first part of it. So this regulatory setup and the legal setup is very important for renewable energy. How does it drive renewable energy? So some of the peculiarities of renewable energy, Soumya ji had already spoken. One is the intermittency part of renewable energy, that is, you can get probably some higher level of power during the peak times when the wind is flowing higher or the sun is has a highest irradiation, as they call it. But at during other times, you don't get it as much. That's one part of it. So the second, the intermittency is one part, and the cost of renewable energy is quite high at one point of time. Now it's substantially reduced. That also we can see. But in this context of promoting renewable energy, the Electricity Act under 86(1)(e) of the Electricity Act has basically said that the regulator can give it his own preferential treatment to renewable energy. So that is, he can fix his feed, it's called feed-in tariff, and ask utilities to buy the electricity produced from this electricity utilities. So that's one thing. Secondly, it can also it is also mandated to have a renewable portfolio obligation. That is, every state, electricity again is not a central subject, it's on the concurrent list. So both the center and the state have an equal role to play in the promotion of electricity in this in India. So that is, even if the central government dictates something, the state necessarily does not have to take it into consideration. They can fine tune the policies and make it in their manner. So that's another thing. So in this context, there is a renewable portfolio obligation. This renewable portfolio obligation basically tells that each state has to have certain level of, based on its resource capacity. That is it, like Swamiji said, in the northern region, there could be more wind. So wind will have a higher higher portfolio within the sun, wind, solar, biomass portfolio. Or in the, let's say in Tamil Nadu, wind has a higher portfolio, sun has a higher resource capacity. So the breakup could be in those manners. So each year the regulator has to dictate a renewable portfolio obligation. That is, this year this utility will purchase purchase 8% of its renewables or 8% of its electricity from renewable energy. That's the way it is. That's the first driver. The second driver is the tariff setting, the competitive bidding, that is, like everybody talks about the competitive bidding process. So these two have set the ground to push investments into renewable energy. So that's the basic thing. So the what has happened from 2003 is that regulators have started giving tariff orders. Just like you get per unit price for electricity, the tariff orders have always been the drivers for investment for renewable energy. So what the regulators, what they do is, they'll say for this particular year, based on the technology and the capacity of the state and all that, you can set up 500 megawatts of renewable energy in Tamil Nadu, for example, of solar power. Based on the solar power, the tariff given for that is per unit will be maybe 5 rupees. Let's say 5 rupees. So this basically drives investors to seek solar, to set up solar power plants in our in our state, in Tamil Nadu, for example. It could be in Andhra, it could be in Karnataka, it could be any other state. So this is what it, this is the basic driver for setting up renewable energy or anything for that matter. So that's the thing. So this is one of the first ideas behind the investment, basic investments of the thing. So given this, this setup, what has happened is, so what basically, this is the way the regulator usually gives the price. So I'll just show you. Okay. So a typical tariff order for solar power will be like this. So the solar tariff order will be like this. What the regulator will do is take into account the lending rate of the bank, take into account the capacity utilization factor or the PLF or CUF they call it, and take into account the insurance and those kind of itemized tariff setting financial conditions are put in, and based on that a tariff order is actually given for solar. So this is what that drives renewable energy in this particular market. So there's again a drive towards who gives the best tariff in this space. So if you see that, if you see Karnataka for example, they could have given a better tariff for renewable energy for solar or for wind. So the investors will prefer Karnataka as a better destination rather than Tamil Nadu. So because each Karnataka has got an electricity regulatory commission. So that's the way the initial stages have gone. Now the shift is gone from tariff setting to competitive bidding. So it's called reverse bidding, where the lowest cost of renewables, where the solar guy bids at, let's say, this is where you get, Soumyaji had saying about 2.6 rupees, 2.6 to 3.
2.41 is the lowest.
Lowest, yeah. Plans to come up in this thing. So one technical aspect about solar power that that is usually said is, solar does not form part of the merit order dispatch, solar or wind. So what happens is that even though you put up a solar plant, it does not have a, okay, every solar plant or wind does not have it does not have a two-part tariff, because you don't, when you have a coal-fired power plant, you have a coal input which is seen as a variable part and a fixed part which is called as a capital part. So in terms of the solar, yes sir, did you say something? Soumyaji? No. So every coal-fired thermal power plant or anything has two-part tariff. One is a variable part and a fixed part. So in a technical background, what happens is that there is a power has to flow through the grid. So in this manner, there's a state load dispatch center is set up. That's called the Tamil Nadu State Load Dispatch Center. What they do, they basically take the cheapest power and direct it to the buyer. So the supplier who's got it. So in this thing, it's called a merit order dispatch. So the cheapest power, which is coal, for example, it could be hydro, it could be the next source. So in this source, the cheapest power is usually the source of the variable cost. That is the cost at which the coal is purchased, the cost at which the hydro is, water is inflow in this thing. Because those are the cheapest power. Because solar does not have a variable cost, that does not have any fuel, because sun does not have a cost. So the fixed cost, which is the three rupees or 4 rupees per unit, is usually taken as the cost of the power plant. So that does not get into the merit order dispatch. Invariably what happens is that solar or other sources do not get into the energy grid. So whenever you see a government document, you basically see that they'll put thermal power plant, hydro and other sources, but leave renewable energy out of the picture, because it does not fall within the normal energy mix. That is one thing that we should consider. And so in this okay, in this again I want to talk about two other things. One is the utility scale solar, which is what Soumya ji was talking about in the morning, and the distributed solar, which is the rooftop solar. So there are, in this differentiation again, government gives two kinds of tariffs, let us say. In Tamil Nadu at least, you have a competitive bidding by the utility scale solar, which is like the Adani plant. Adani plant is 500 megawatts, it's set up in Kumuthi. So this particular power plant is 500 megawatts, and they have a power purchase agreement with the utility. Based on this power purchase agreement, the Adani plant sells power to this to Tangedco for here. So, but the utility, the rooftop solar has a different pricing mechanism, at least in Tamil Nadu. In Tamil Nadu, what happens, you have a power credit system. So, in utilities, in rooftop solar, you don't get paid. Whatever solar you put up on your roof, you're basically given a credit system. One, if you sell, if you're buying, let's say your monthly consumption is 100 units. If you are going to sell 80 units to Tangedco, it gets offset in your bill. Tangedco does not give you any money for that. So it's like a credit system that is in place. So there are different mechanisms in this. But the idea again is that all these factors drive the renewable energy industry in at least in India. These are the factors, primary factors. And some of the problems which they face in terms of investment, this thing, now I'm making it look like a more marketing thing, but the idea again is that what has happened, at least in the rooftop solar space, is that utilities are unwilling to allow customers to set up rooftop solar. The idea again is that the utilities they will lose their customers. If you are putting a rooftop solar, you are going to be self-sufficient in your consumption. So then what happens? The utility loses that revenue that you are paying them. So in that way, they give a roadblock to the solar market. Secondly, what happens is that the cost, at least when I spoke to a couple of developers, the quality of the panels is not proven, and the rate at which the bidders quote the price is not feasible to set up a solar, at least at the utility scale level, a solar proper solar mechanism. So the installations that they usually tell about is the idea behind this solar thing is more a land grab mechanism rather than actually wanting to set up the solar plants, is one thing. So I think more or less covered, but maybe I'll probably talk about it.
Volume, energy down.
Energy?
My energy down.
Yes.
In India, almost, I read in magazines, almost except 20 or 25 days in Asia, all the 345 days you are able to get solar power. Right? Yes. Except in very few states like Kashmir, where the winter is there and solar
question.
So in spite of that, why they have not made the optimum use of the solar system? And it's fundamental solar. And secondly, the windmill, especially
wind turbines. Winds are for mechanical energy, turbines are for electricity.
Yeah, both for mechanical and for domestic purposes. In fact, also, there are a pretty number of windmills and wind turbines. A huge plant. But the problem is, they are able to produce. Initially, the government gave so much of incentives like the IT rebate, depreciation, loan, subsidy, all these things. Now, gradually, due to the pressure from various sources, they have been reducing the water.
The incentives they have reduced.
And it's not being popular. And secondly, the takeover of the government from the consumers or the manufacturers also going up. They don't properly pay for it.
Yeah.
That it would make the large scale investment in the grid completely redundant. Is this
Let's start with these three questions and then if more comes. Quickly, because we don't have
volume.
You can store electricity as electricity. See, the moment I was living in Delhi earlier, 2004 I moved out of Delhi just to the periphery, Ghaziabad. In Delhi I used to have half an hour to 1 hour maximum power cut. The moment I moved 2 kilometers outside Delhi, I had 8 hours of power cut every day. So I installed an inverter, and with that 150 milliampere hour lead acid battery. So for me, that battery supplied 6 to 7 hours of my domestic power except the fridge comfortably. So one very clear solution, and battery technology has improved tremendously over the last 10 years. Very soon you will have wall mounted batteries. Very soon this will be a little expensive to begin with. The Tesla Powerwall kind of thing is already in the market. It will be a little expensive to begin with. When mass production starts, the power prices will come down. But those have other problems. Lithium has other problems. But that's beyond this storage issue. So we will have very soon batteries, very small batteries, capable of storing fairly large amount of power for your domestic needs. Then there is a industrial battery storage that has been developed. There is a compressed air storage technology. When you have a surplus power, you underground caves, you put in airtight caves, you put in air at very high pressure. When you need the power, you run turbines, air turbines. Those are there. Then there are pump storage, like you have reservoirs already where.
Those are very expensive.
Not very expensive. The cost of the per unit power works out to much less than new generation capacity. These are very generalized statement, very expensive.
So
the cost.
But in Tamil Nadu, we have studied, I've studied, actually the current storage they have, for 1 unit of energy that goes up, you need more than 1 unit of energy.
Obviously.
For 1 unit of energy that comes down, you need more than 1 unit. So
you generate 1 unit and you actually the pumping total energy will be more than 1 unit because no process is 100% efficient. That's a physical constant. But if you have energy surplus, energy being generated, over the last 3 months, again in the last year it happened, in Germany, in Denmark, there were days where more than the entire German electricity demand was being generated by the wind and solar. What do you do with that? It's there. You have already put up the plant. The plant is producing power you don't need at that point of time. So unless you stop it, that's the wastage. But if you can use that energy, nobody is there in the market. Use that energy to store it, either pump storage or a compressed air or eutectic salts. Eutectic salts are a technology that is ideally suited for solar. Because here what happens is you tap the solar energy as heat, which is much cheaper than solar photovoltaic panels. There are high voltage melting salts. You just make underground chambers where these salts are there and these are melted when heat is passed through them. And when you need the energy, you use that heat to run a turbine. So these are, but every stage has a loss involved because no process in world is 100% efficient. Like even if you charge the battery and take the battery power back, it will be total efficiency will be 85%. So 15% you lose. That means you have an additional burden of 15%, 20%. That's if you have excess power, what do? You lose 20%, but the rest 80% you store. So storage technologies are evolving. There are at least 11 different kinds of storage technologies. But apart from that, what we today have is hybrid systems. Often you will see in a place, wind is there, sun is low. When it's cloudy and windy, sun is low. So if you put a hybrid system, a wind and a solar system, often when there is very little wind, solar, there will be high wind. Often where there is very little wind, there is high sun. So you can combine that. And on the Third, today we have smart grids. The grids can sense where the power demands are, because throughout the day, like you go out in the, say, 9 o'clock to office, and your power demand drastically drops. 7 o'clock, 7:30, Delhi winter, you switch on the heater, geyser, power demand shoots up. So smart grids can sense based on intelligent systems, and they can distribute the demand and supply from different sources to different consuming centers. So different areas, along with renewables, smart grids are a necessity. These are now being applied more and more. So the problem of intermittency of renewable power, to a certain extent, the three things, the storage, multiple storage technologies, hybrid systems, and smart grids, these are taken care of. Countries far more industrialized, far more energy intensive economies like Germany. Germany is the industrial powerhouse of Europe. The most of the industrial production per person per GDP happens in Germany. If Germany can use 90% of renewable power for its entire electricity need for months and months together, so there is, at this point of time, there is no technical difficulty. You will have to put just beyond that additional immediate generation, you have to add 20% maybe for storage, smart grids, and hybridization, hybrid supplies. So this is a challenge, but there are many solutions, feasible solutions today. Of course, the upfront investment in the storage, etc., will increase a little bit. And in there, today, the renewables being reasonable cost, we can invest that. Because the other point that I didn't tell in the first two presentation, every form of energy production and consumption has an external cost. And that externality is the highest in coal and nuclear, if you consider all the other cost. Externality in solar is much lower. So any form of power production, you have to also take on the external cost. And it is the industry's own estimate. They published a report, a couple of reports in 2011, saying at that point of time, today we are in 2011, the external cost of utilities, power companies, all kinds of power companies, was 87% of EBITDA. Of EBITDA, earnings before interest, tax, depreciation, amortization. EBITDA is a industrial commercial term, accounting term. The earnings before interest, tax, depreciation, amortization. That's the total earning. 87% of that, the industry do not pay, you as a consumer do not pay. Who pays? The person who stays behind that, whose crops are grown, the ecology, and the person who becomes sick as a result of that, all of them pay. And this 87% do not include the health cost. And the projection also said in the next 11 years, this will double. This was a report by the business groups, global business groups, saying the new way of doing business. You have to change the way you do business. You have to change the way you generate electricity and power. So this is industry's own estimate. So I'll say this is underestimate. If we do, we'll do it much higher. So, and health is not included in this 87%. So that, I'm ending it at that. So there are, you have to, when you take the cost, oh, cost will increase. You have to take the external cost also. And solar has a very low external cost. Wind has even lower external cost. So those external costs are never calculated by industry into their accounts book. These are always outside the account books. So that needs to be taken into account. That's what ecological economics is all about. The second question was about what? About your questions? That solar, why these are not given enough incentives? See, as Vishnu was also trying to explain, in a sense there are incentives. In 28 states of India, there is a net metering policy. You can, as a private citizen, you can put up a 3 or 5 kilowatt solar photovoltaic plant on your roof. By law, you are allowed to connect with the grid. By law, the distribution company is supposed to enter an agreement with you for 25 years. And if you are generating excess electricity, then you are consuming. Because in the night, you will not be generating, you will still be consuming. So it's the meter runs reverse. When you generate more, the meter runs reverse. When you consume, meter runs in the right direction. At the end of the month, generally at a 2-month period, the utility is supposed to give you money. In Tamil Nadu, they are not giving money, but other places they are supposed to give you money. And these schemes have been advertised. But what really happens is, at the ground level, when I apply, the utility officers, the power company, distributing, they put so many hurdles. Oh, you, this is not right. This form has not filled right. You go and do it. Oh, this is, you have not done this. You have not done this certificate. Go and do this. They don't want it to happen. There is a government policy. Even before that, there was a government policy that if you are installing a renewable energy system, you will get bank loan at 2% interest. It is there. How many people have installed because of that? Because the banks were always trying to say, oh, yes, it is there, but bring it, bring this, do it correctly. The banks don't want to give. There are reasons for that. We'll go into this later on. But the utility companies, because they see a fall in their business, if they have to pay at that assured rate to all the consumer, there is a huge management cost. If 10 lakh people put up solar power plants or solar wind hybrids or wind power plant and they start selling, those 10 lakh accounts have to be maintained, 10 lakh meters have to be checked, and how much they have to pay, this payment process, it's a huge management burden. So there is a need, there is a challenge how to simplify this process. This has been done in Germany, this has been done in some European countries. There are communities which are doing this, there are communities which have gone entirely off the grid. There are a community of 15,000 families which have gone entirely out of the grid. They are self-sufficient in their power requirement in Germany.
See, Adani is given so much of incentive.
No, I am coming to that. Adani, and that's what we said. Adani, Ambani, Dhani, Mani, Gani, everyone is being given incentive. But it's not only land grab. Land grab is one purpose. It's not only land grab. Because the kind of incentives, land is one component. Like Rajasthan is the biggest expanding solar power plant state. Tamil Nadu, Gujarat has expanded earlier. Tamil Nadu has gone very big on the wind. Rajasthan is the biggest expanding in solar and also wind. Rajasthan has put solar wind turbines all across the western districts. Jodhpur, Phalodi, Jaisalmer, everywhere you go you see this. There are other impacts, but the incentives, one, they are giving land at 1/10 the circle rate. So that's one. Second, what is happening is in Rajasthan, I was just touching on, as a result of this, they are putting the power plants in areas where the villages also use that land as their common land, which is creating conflict. Because in Rajasthan, rainfall is very sparse, 140 mm in the Jaisalmer district per year, 140 mm, nothing. So they grow one crop, but their livelihood depends on animal husbandry, like pasture land. And those pasture lands have been taken. 10,000 hectares have been enclosed as solar parks. So their pasture lands is gone. Three villages have one sweet water well. That's their lifeline. That has been given to the solar company. Solar don't need too much of water. Coal, nuclear need huge amount of water. But solar companies also need to wash the panels once a week or once in 8 days or 10 days, depending on the dust level. And that's why the well has been given to the solar company. So the people, they don't bother so much of their own drinking water, but the drinking water for their animal is extremely important. So this used to come from the same well that has been enclosed now. So these are leading to a lot of conflicts. In fact, these are leading to people resisting solar and wind power plants, large scale. I have met them, I'm part of their effort to lodge a case. The courts have dismissed, oh, pollution, there is no pollution. Those are many, many issues are there. That's why when I was talking about, I said the renewable energies have many issues of pollution, of rights, of commons, which we don't talk about normally. But that doesn't mean renewables cannot supply our energy. There are ways to do that. I have been to Chhattisgarh. We have done a study in Chhattisgarh. Much before other so-called progressive states don't have anything, Chhattisgarh has established 1,300 solar microgrids in villages deep inside forests. At the time when solar panels were very expensive, and I have visited them in 2015, did a study 2015 and 16, these are still running. Villages inside Achanakmar Tiger Reserve, Adivasi villages, are still getting electricity from the solar microgrid established in 2005 and 2006 and 2007. So this is possible, and there what we have found, it leaves a little bit of land. And there are large amounts of land in the villages. two farmers and given their land, the land that needed to be put the solar panels on, 8 kilowatt, 9 kilowatt, 10 kilowatt plants, good enough for a small village. They gave it voluntarily, no money. Okay, everyone will get electricity, I'll give small part of my land voluntarily. It has happened. And the government came, gave the support, put up the solar panels, put up the batteries, and these are running. They trained a local person to maintain, and they asked for 10 rupees from each household per month. A lot of people are not giving that 10 rupees, that's another question. The moment we get an opportunity, okay, we can give, can get a, even not paying 10, that we do, whether Adivasi or non-Adivasi. That's the reality of Indian mentality. But that is operating. So there are incentives, there are multiple levels of incentives on policy and paper. But the implementation stage, lot of people are actually putting obstacles. So that's possible. How you do it is up to you. There are many methods, many people have tried. There is no single method how to pressurize the government. That's activism, that's what consumer activism or other activism is all about. That you have to decide. So here there are around 40 people. So you decide to pressurize the Tamil Nadu government. And how do you do it? What will be their methodology is up to you. We don't know how it will work in Tamil Nadu. I'm trying to mobilize some Rajasthan villages. Any power plant, even a solar power plant, say 500 crore solar power plant, 80 to 85% of the money comes from the banks. 15 to 20% money is brought forward by the promoters. Often, because of over-invoicing, even that is a little less. I'm not talking about the corruption, I'm not going into the corruption, that's the reality. So 10-15% of the money, the villagers are willing to put up. In the Jaisalmer and Jodhpur districts, I have talked to a lot of villagers who are now really troubled by these large-scale solar and wind utility farms. They are willing to put up that money. I helped organize a couple of villages, including big village called Kanoi in Jodhpur district. They are willing to put up the money for 20%. I talked to the last who retired 3 years ago, director of solar energy thing in the Rajasthan Renewable Energy Development Agency. And I'm quoting you, when I told him that these villagers are now ready, would you also facilitate the way you are facilitating big companies? That person, I'm not naming anyone, said, no, I'll not give them the chance. This, and some adjective he used, they'll never give us back. Whereas the person sitting next to, after a little bit, he said, my 2000 crores are still stuck there in the same village outside there. He was from Mozabeer. He was some director in Mozabeer. They are putting up a big power plant. If you are putting up a 2000 crore power plant, it's very easy to give a 20 crore facilitation incentives. But if you are a group of farmers, you can't give even 1 crore. Policy, on the Electricity Act, he is trying. There are a lot of other things which happened as a result of the Electricity Act. Before 2000, there were 11% of power plants which are under private ownership. Today, it is 44%. Contribution of the Electricity Act. Now, the Electricity Act, what he didn't mention, was not meant for some facilitation. What happened 20 years before the Electricity Act came in 2003, is large Indian industries, corporations, went to the government, said that we do not have the financial capacity to invest in the entire chain, generation, transmission, distribution. Facilitate our ownership. The government and the corporates discussed, and the decision was, in a future date, this will be unbundled so that the privates can invest either in the generation or in the distribution, which is the most profitable thing was seen as distribution in that time. So the Electricity Act didn't come out of the sky. Nobody dropped it from the sky. It was a pressure of the Indian corporates to get ownership of electricity resources. Because at that point of time, nobody envisaged electricity will be surplus in India. If you remember, even 10 years ago, electricity was always in shortage. Always the good that produce and sell and profit.
So nobody envisaged today's situation, and that was the reason this Electricity Act brought in this unbundling, because the private corporations told very clearly, we don't have the money to invest in the entire chain. Give us segments where you can invest and profit and make it privatized. So as a result, from 11%, we have 44% private ownership of power plants today. So try to look into the deeper workings of the policies. The policies are not like government brought in something. There are deeper workings in the policies also.